Everyone, hi. Good evening, everyone. We'll start in next 3 to 4 minutes. Yes, thank you for being here, everyone. Good evening. Before I start, if somebody can just let me know that I'm audible.
Yeah, you are audible.
Yes, Nikita, you are audible.
Thank you so much. Okay. So to start with today, hello all, very good afternoon. Myself, Ekta Dubey, and on behalf of the Brenalytics team and our partner VCS and OSI, we welcome you all on a roundtable that's Profit from Process Efficiencies through Industry 4.0 Pharmaceutical. So before we start the roundtable, there are a few guidelines that I would like to highlight and make you people aware of, requesting all the attendees to be on mute when the speakers are taking the sessions. We would be having a Q&A session. So there are certain guidelines that would be I would be highlighting. You need to raise your hands, unmute yourself on your video, introduce yourself and put your question to the concerned speaker. So that these are the basic guidelines. And the most important thing is to be on mute when the speakers are taking the session. Plus, if anybody has logged in through gadgets, kindly rename it. Help us, to understand who is registered with us, and we can share with you the entire video link after the roundtable. So thank you. So now to start with, I would first like to introduce our title partner, VCS. VCS offers digitally intelligent solutions worldwide. It includes real-time monitoring and analytics, IIoT integration, edge analytics, digital logbook, and predictive analysis using AI/ML. VCS takes the responsibility to engage with client in opportunity assessment, calculating value of improvement, building a business blueprint, delivering required hardware, software, services, and support to ensure that the improvement initiatives is successfully implemented. To start with the session, first I would like to highlight why we are all here today, a little brief and intro about the roundtable. So the dawn of Pharma 4.0 has brought about a precedence of smart manufacturing with AI, IoT, and automation. Such technologies are increasingly prevalent and have become crucial to the continued success and the competitiveness of today's global manufacturers. This insightful roundtable would focus on the best strategies and the practices and how the emerging technologies that characterize Industry 4.0, from connectivity to advanced analytics, robotics, and automation, have become the potential to revolutionize every element of pharma manufacturing labs. We are having some great leaders today who are going to share their insights on various topics. So now I would like to welcome Mr. Kamaldeep Singh, Executive Director and CEO with Value Chain Solutions India Private Limited. To speak about him, he's a strategic leader with more than 25 years of experience in operations and information technology management. He has worked with life sciences, metal and mining, chemicals, cement, paper, pots, oil and gas companies to help them improve productivity, efficiency, and reducing operating costs through digital transformation in various areas. Over to you, Mr. Kamaldeep, to share your thoughts initially. Thank you for being here.
Yes, Kamal is not able to join. I think he's on mute.
Yes, no problem. Yeah. We have.
So, I think Kamal is here. So, Kamal.
Yes.
Thanks so much. I think Shranik, you can start. I'm seeing some audio issues.
Yeah, okay. So good afternoon, everyone. Ekta, thank you for a brief introduction about Value Chain Solution and the subject that you talked about. On behalf of Value Chain Solution Brand Analytics team, I would like to welcome all the esteemed guests joining this roundtable. The idea of this particular thing is to get like-minded thought leaders on this single platform to exchange the ideas on how together we can change the way Industry 4.0 can bring a revolution in pharma domain, and to ensure that we all are on the same page, how jointly we can formalize applications and structure which can be beneficial to all the stakeholders and the thought leaders. And this platform, we've been running this particular platform for the past 3 months. The idea is to exchange thoughts by getting all the thought leaders on a single platform for different domains. And today we are doing it for pharma domain. So we have got thought leaders and strategic thinkers from that particular domain, and to see to it that we all can contribute to this particular domain and create value for that. So once again, thank you all the stakeholders and thought leaders for joining this particular roundtable, and hope you enjoy this particular thing and do provide your feedback to us so that we can continue these series of roundtables and get the right thought leaders on a single platform, which can create a lot of value for everyone. So once again, thank you and hope you enjoy this session. Over to you, Ekta.
Yes, thank you, Shran. So now I would first like to invite Mr. Praveen Jadhav to share his thoughts, to speak about him. He's a country manager, managing business for all South Asia countries of OSI Soft, now the part of Aviva. He's a technology evangelist, helping enterprises and organizations to understand and solve their challenges with data-driven approach, importance of real-time data, data analytics, IT/OT, convergence for improving their operations and business. So over to you, Mr. Praveen Jadhav, to share your thoughts. And thank you for being with us today.
Thanks, Ekta. It's been great. And thanks for this opportunity. It's delighted to speak to you all. As Ekta mentioned, I'm Praveen Jadhav. I head the pie business for South Asia. Earlier it was Oasis Soft, and now it's a part of Aviva. And during this session, I would like to just share some of my experiences working with various pharma companies and best practices. And I've seen their digital journeys, you know, where they have moved towards the process efficiency, improving their quality and asset reliability. I have made a couple of slides. Ekta, I'm allowed to share my screen?
Yeah, Praveen, I think you are allowed to share your screen. Sure, you've been the co-host. Yeah.
Are you guys able to see my screen now?
Yeah, we are able to see your screen.
Sorry, just give me a second.
Just get into a presentation mode, that's it.
Yep, right. So basically, you know, as we really look at it today, we have a new opportunity. Over the past few years, we've been looking at companies and individuals have time to pause and reflect the new ways of working, right? The new growth initiatives, what we are kind of looking at, new imperatives which have emerged now. And as a business leaders, now it has become very important for all of us to really look and see how faster we can run to realize a sustainable and, you know, create a sustainable model for a future through a digital transformation journey. And it has become more important now to look at the digital transformation part of it. And it is more essential ever to look at and see how we can ahead of the competition part of it. And there's no surprise, even if this kind of a word, we see that most of the analysts have kept this digital working and digital connected worker on the top of their analysis, which they have been putting out for a main priority part of it. So it is very important to look at it. How do we really look at from the survival to hope part of it? So when we look at the imperatives part of it, you know, we always have a fluctuating, market environment. We are looking at a sustainable model of working and then, you know, creating a new way of looking at the market part of it. We always come to a part of it where we have cloud solutions. You are talking about a big data analytics. Are you talking about a digital infrastructure? Are creating the complete artificial intelligence layer structures? All these are going to really create a value-added working where the strategies will be bringing around these drivers to make more focuses towards making a better living and health. We're looking from a balancing risk of return of investment and everything. It's very imperative for pharma part of it, you know, to look at the regulatory compliance, have a real-time data analysis part of it. Also, to make the data available for the right person to make effective decisions part of it is critically important. It's really important to look at Pharma 4.0. It's a time where we find out a way, how do we work, in terms of making decisions to really look at the quality part of it, making a value-added throughput, where we collect all the data and segregate the data and make a realistic view of creating an operational excellence. And, it is also important to have a complete view of the circle way of looking at the Pharma 4.0. So I'm just running in. I just want to give more time for Sarang in terms of, he can share more views from his perspective, how they are kind of streaming that part of it. But Pi's been, extensively used by most of the customers. These are set of few customers what we have in the list. Most of these customers have been using Pi as their digital infrastructure, driving their complete initiatives on Pi system. If you really look at it from a top 25 pharmaceutical companies, they completely rely on the Pi system. It will look at it, 11% of asset utilization increases there. Dr. Reddy's has been using Pi system and have improved real-time visibility, process reliability, and throughput. I think this is something which I wanted to share across from my end, Shrenik and Ekta. Over to you back again. Thank you.
Thank you, Praveen. Thank you for your insights. Ekta, over to you.
Yes, thank you so much. So now I would request Mr. Sarang Pandey to come and share his thoughts, to speak about Sarang Pandey. Sarang is a business engagement lead manufacturing system at Dr. Reddy's Laboratories, Hyderabad. He's an expert in business translation for implementation of Industry 4.0 solutions, including various advanced analytics-based solutions, created an overall impact on various business KPIs performance, strong pharmaceutical manufacturing domain knowledge, an effective communicator with excellent relationship building skills, problem-solving abilities, and detail-oriented attitude. Over to you, Mr. Sarang, to share your thoughts. And thank you for being with us today. Mr. Sarang, over to you.
Sarang, I think you're on mute. Or
we can see your presentation, Sarang.
Yeah, Sarang, you're on mute. So you'll need to unmute yourself.
Good afternoon, everyone. Am I audible?
Yeah. You're audible now. You're able to see also. Yeah.
Yes, all clear. Thank you, Saran. Thank you for being here.
Yeah. Thanks. Thanks, Ekta. Thank Shrenik for the introduction. So without wasting any time, maybe I'll take this opportunity to showcase what we could able to achieve with respect to Industry 4.0 in Dr. Reddy's and with the help of Value Chain Solutions and with the help of Voices of Pi. So before that, just the introduction of Dr. Reddy's laboratory. As everyone is aware, we are into three major domains, that is pharmaceutical services and APIs, active ingredients, global generic, that is mainly formulations and proprietary products. And we have presence in almost commercial presence in almost 30 countries with 9 API manufacturing factory facilities, 13 formulation facilities. We have 9 global R&D centers and 1 biologic development center. So this is about Dr. Reddy's, and directly I'll jump into the Industry 4.0 enablement for efficiency improvement. So why do we want to do it? So each manufacturing facility wants to achieve best performance, best in class performance that defines the role model for other companies to follow in their particular sector. And we truly believe that all these Industry 4.0 technologies are helping us to reach at in top decile. We are calling it as a top decile, or which sets benchmark to others so that we are best in various operational metrics. And how these are helping us, that is explained here. So when we are saying Industry 4.0 technologies, or are aware, there are various technologies like AI, ML, then IoT, Internet of Things, data lake, big data lake and analytics, augmented reality and virtual reality, digital twin, and real-time tracking and visualization. All these are various components of Industry 4.0 technologies. But alone with these technologies, we may not able to achieve the impact on the business or profit, the title for which we are here. It can be achieved with the step change in the performance. And when it is integrated with the all these use cases are deployed at scale. And third is, whatever technology that we are implementing, initially we are taking a pilot approach, but when we are scaling it up, that platform which what we are choosing, it should be scalable, easily scalable. So combination of all these things will help us in unlocking the business value. So with this, how now we have used all these technologies and how we have culminated all the three levers, and we are calling it as enablers, which we feel that we could able to get some business value from this. Before that, I would like to touch one of the important Industry 4.0 is the big data. We are calling it as a big data lake, where we have engaged with Oasis and Value Chain Solutions. So why the need of big data has emerged? As you are aware, in order to have all this Industry 4.0 technologies, the base process which we are working, right, a base process of shop floor manufacturing, quality control labs, the documentation happening, the quality management system, the safety systems, all these base processes need to be digitized. Then only all this Industry 4.0 technology benefit can be there. So we have started this journey a few years back, and as you can see, all the processes, right, from level 1 to level 2, level 3 and level 4 are digitized. And they are interconnected, means shop floor to top floor. Shop floor equipment is connected with the SAP. So that level of integration, as per ISO 95, we have achieved. And since now all the base data is digitized, then we were having an opportunity that we could able to make data-driven decisions. We can able to do the data serviceability, and we could able to do a foundation for all the DNA use cases. But in order to make all these use cases to work, all this data, all the system data should be available at a single platform. And that platform is the, Am I audible, team?
Yeah, please go ahead. Sorry.
Yeah. So where then there is a need of data lake, and we believe Pi system has played an important role in the building the data lake journey. As you can see, our data lake is built on Hortonworks Hadoop and OrisaSoft, where all our history and the time series data is connected with the OrisaSoft, and all the process parameter data, historians data, all these data points are now connected to Pi, and we are sending these data to data lake. And the system like SAP, MES, LIMS, LMS, all these are connected to the base system is the Hadoop. And this system of aggregation of all the systems at a single data layer is now creating a platform or a base to have all the DNA use cases which are using all Industry 4.0 technologies. So here we have Pi system has played an instrumental role here in order to establish this connect. So we will touch the use cases one by one. And I just wanted to give the glimpse how we have validated the Pi system and how many systems are connected as an overview. So as all of us are aware, we work in regulated environment, means whatever systems that we are putting, those systems need to be qualified, validated, and these data points need to be complying to the US FDA 21 CFR and EU Annexure 11. So we connected this Pi system, we proved all these requirements, and then we started replicating, connecting all these historian systems. And we could able to complete a total around 29 to 30 systems are connected to Pi systems. And we have seen the robust performance of Pi system. And here we have used the various functionalities like Pi data framework, Pi asset framework, event frame, notifications, visions, Pi system access, and various connectors and interfaces to fetch the data from various source system. While since it is a long journey, around two and a half to 3 years, we were having learnings that Pi asset framework is the key of success of all these use cases. And defining this app in aptly manner defines the success of the DNA use case replication. Pi event frame is definitely, being into the batch industry, event frame is the key which gives us the data at multi-layer details. And when we connect this system, we have not seen any impact on the source system performance. It is intact. And overall, when we are implementing, we failed that. If we are making aware the team, then impact on creating the use cases are very high. So this is at a Pi system implementation layer. Now I'll walk you through the three use cases where we have used Pi system and a component of Industry 4.0 technology. So first use case, I will talk about the machine setting, as we are into the tablet manufacturing area. So compression is the major operation where powders are getting converted into tablet. But when each tablet, before we start the commercial manufacturing, the machine setting has to be done in a such a way that required hardness, thickness, group weight need to be achieved prior to the actual batch manufacturing. And it is totally dependent on that operator's experience on that particular product and particular machine. So in order to neutralize this experience, we have whatever data that we historize with the help of Pi, and the data, the raw material data which we are getting, we could able to create models. And that models is now we are using to guide the operator how to set up a machine. And we now, earlier for each setup, we used to take 30 to 60 minutes or 5 to 6 rounds, and that was leading to the wastage. And as you have seen in the screen, we have used almost all components from the Pi data archive, asset framework, event frames, all major components of the Pi we have used in this use case. And machine learning, one of the Industry 4.0 technology we have used. So combination of this has resulted into what operator is now entering the batch number. From that batch number, operator is getting the machine parameters prescription which need to be set based on that particular product's performance historically. And for that batch, the quality of raw material which is issued for manufacturing. It's a combination of that. Operator is getting a few parameters that need to be set, and machine is getting set in one or two rounds. So you can see the rejection quantity, repetitions, and everything has got down by 60%. And rejection quantity also got down by 60%. So this is the direct benefit we are getting batch after batch and products after products. So this is one benefit. Second use case, we would like to touch upon the golden tunnel. As everyone is aware, golden tunnel is a very is a buzzword that is getting used in pharma, that everyone is expected that our quality should be always in a golden tunnel. There should not be any variation. But in order to achieve that, we should also control the parameters which are impacting to reach to that layer. So here, issues were there that we were having product failures in certain quality attributes. And when a product is failed, the normal tendency is to take out the data, do the multivariate analysis, find any root cause, and find any lead indicators which have caused a lag indicator, not lead, lag indicator, which has caused to this delay. But rather than doing this analysis ad hoc basis, what approach we have taken is we have finalized the parameters which are impacting that particular quality attributes behavior. We have found out with the help of principal component analysis, we have found the principal components which are important and that need to be calculated at a 1 minute interval, and deploy this particular equation at a runtime using the PySet framework. So here the data lake, OrisaSoft is having a real-time streaming analytics at 1 minute interval it is streaming, and we have developed this model into Python. So all these three industry 4.0 technology we have used, and being the Py system's capability of streaming a complex calculation or complex equation at a real time by having the data points, this has helped us to achieve to guide operator. While operator is regularly sees 15-16 parameters data, now he need not to see all 15-16 parameters. He can only see the single trend. And you can see this is the tunnel and this is the principal component analysis index that is coming. And he has to monitor this only. And when the batch is between this tunnel, we will not have failures of that particular CQA, and that process capability index is increased more than 1.33. So these are the benefits that we are getting. And here operators are getting real-time alerts. Because this principle, it is dependent on multiple parameters, for 13, 14 parameters, but which parameter, if this particular trend is behaved, which parameter is caused this trend to behave not properly. So there are real-time notification that with the help of Py notification, we could able to send. So these are one good benefits that we have seen. Now the third use case I want to discuss about the condition-based maintenance with the help of IoT. And here, as you are aware, in pharma industry, there are equipment like mesh compressions, dryers, boosters, coaters. These are important equipment. And if there is any breakdown happens, then there is a chances of, if it breakdown happens during the batch, then there is a chances of we need to throw that batch because of unplanned downtime happened during the batch manufacturing. There is an unplanned changeover time it is happening, and entirely it is a totally lost business. Then what solution that team has worked with along with Py, it's a failure mode analysis that we are continuously doing. And on the failure mode analysis, team could able to find certain tags are already available in Py through Historian, but certain tags are not available, like vibration, like temperature sensor of the temperature of the motor, vibration of the motor. These tags are not available. Then along with this tag and along with the process parameter tag available in Historian, these tags are connected with Py, and then based on the operator's experience, OEM inputs, and based on the FMEA, alerts were generated. And these alerts, their two-layer approach that we followed, action limit and alert limit, And with this alert, without once that particular trend is reached, which we are monitoring on a real-time basis, a notification is sent if that alert is limit, and team is taking the action on a real-time basis on to resolve this all these issues. This has benefited operators in order to maintain mean time between failure of this particular machine to increase by 100%. You can see the one of the functionalities that we have used, the real-time display, PI Vision display, where health of the machine is getting reported with the trend line. And if there are certain notifications, we have developed a notification where the root cause and a engineer that correct action which need to be taken, everything will be notified so that the mean time to repair is getting reduced. Rather than looking for many things, what he need to look for, that is also defined. So this is how we have designed this design condition-based maintenance, where we have seen more than 100% improvement in mean time between failure, which is that is the KPI that is getting monitored. So now I'm connecting back to the all Industry 4.0 technologies, where what we have seen, AI, ML, data lake analytics, digital twin. Digital twin in this case is the machine asset that we have converted. That asset details, asset health parameters are converted into the real-time PI Vision displays, and that is a digital twin. Real-time tracking, that is a golden tunnel that we have helped, and the IoT. These are the technologies that has helped to step change in the performance. Here, integrated use case, and these are the use cases that are deployed, because we are now scaling up all these use cases in the plant and across the network, because whatever technology, the data lake and PI system, this is a scalable platform. So this is how we could able to extract the benefit out of all this investment. Yeah, this is what I had planned to discuss. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Mr. Sarang, for sharing your insights. So do we have any questions? Before we move to the round table, we can have a quick question. So the guidelines I've already mentioned is that you need to raise your hands, unmute yourself, and put your questions with Mr. Praveen, Mr. Sarang, or Shrenik, with any questions with any speaker. Or you can also mention, keep the chat box engaged, you know, by putting up your insights or sharing thoughts or a question.
Ekta, I have one question to Sarang.
Yes, Nitesh, please go ahead. Sarang,
hi, this is Nitesh. I'm working for Unichem. And the thing is, we have just recently started this project of going online through our SCADA project. And a lot many challenges are coming up, especially regarding integration of machine with software. And major challenge is when we configure, there are a lot of software which are not supporting our existing machine. In that case, either we need to upgrade that machine to current version, and the software provider and the machine provider, their link should be proper. So how you have handled it at your end?
Yeah. So the good part in our case was when we implemented those machines or equipment, we ensured that the respective protocol through which that particular equipment can talk to a third party. In your case, it is a SCADA that you are using, that it should able to give the data to that particular platform, so that we will not have issues when we connect any equipment to the SCADA. So this is how, so that care, the project team taken that care during the implementation of the SCADA layer itself.
Okay. Even to the extent, sometimes the challenge is in this bargain, we lose a lot of productivity, because you know how the commercial market is focused, and we have to integrate a lot many challenges we face here. But anyway, it is little time consuming and taking its own time, because see, here it is not just fixing something and start. Correct. It is like one system should bind with other, and then things will be in place. So correct. That is what we basically see when it comes to integration. So correct. Almost for 50% of the equipment we have started now. And this project started somewhere in 2018, mid of 2018, and still we are integrating, and a lot many things are to be done. that's what the challenge is. So what was the period you covered all this thing at your end?
So Nitesh, because you are referring to a business case of connecting equipment to a particular L2 layer. Okay, that is the case. And what I had described is L3 layer. So for me, already those equipments were connected to L2 layer. Almost the same period, it is based on the number of equipment which need to be connected to that particular L2 layer. But I believe the team could have completed, because it's in one plant, if it is to be done, it will take roughly around 2 to 2.5 years to complete the plant. If 100 plus equipment, it will definitely take, because each equipment itself is a project to connect to that layer. And unless we match the particular tag data, instrument tag data into the historian data as a part of PQ, then only we can use this data point. So 2+ years would be the answer.
Yes, I think I'm not taking too much time. The third question is, we were talking about all production equipment. But what about other equipment, like integration of production, engineering, and QC? Because all these are in one chain. So something integration is possible to take into account.
Just a minute. So if you can see here, so process equipments are connected to this Rockwell immersion, all these systems, and lab is to instruments are connected to Empower, and in Empower everything. So lab process is happening in LIMS and manufacturing process is happening in EMS. This is how we have digitized the shop floor.
Okay, but you all have done integration of production with QC LIMS. It's
really no. Means like this you are expecting, right?
Yeah.
From equipment LIMS, we don't find any use case. Or you are referring to MES and LIMS?
MES and LIMS is it's fine.
Equipment to LIMS, we didn't find any use case, so we have not done.
Okay. What about a utility? Because what I can see, this Anvil and all BMS. What about utilities? Like your what a system?
Utility is the area where we have not applied. We are not connected to our data lake. It is still to be digitized stage only.
Yes. Thank you.
Yeah. Sarang, this is Shaligram. Just the one small question from my side. So I'm working with Lupin right now. And thanks for your presentation. It's a real case, I can say. Actually, because of this pandemic situation, you must have a lot of benefit because of this implementation of correct. The 4.0. Correct. So just have you faced any audit, regulatory audit with this system?
So with PI system, no, because basically in our case, PI system, we are acting it as a analytics layer, where we are this data what we are storing.
Mm-hmm.
What the data which we are storing is used for the use cases which I showed right now. But the use cases like online process verification and online APQR, that we are in a phase of qualification. And once it is qualified, once we start putting it into operation, then it will be exposed to the audit. So right now, since we have completed all the documentation, but per se, means we have not faced any audit with this document.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Sanand. Thank you, Mr. Shari Gramrani, for the question.
Yeah, so, one question from my side.
Yes, Mr. Rajendra, please go ahead.
Yeah. Hello, Sarang. This is Rajendra Dadich from Ipka Laboratories.
Hello.
And glad, thanks first of all to give this insight of this entire thing, and I'm really impressed. And my question is also related to the manufacturing operations and something what Mr. Nitin also asked. During manufacturing operation, like, you know, we are also talking about the temperature, RH, and delta P. that is also integral part of the entire manufacturing operations, that how it should be there. So how that was connected in this overall system architecture?
Yeah. So that is, we are calling that data points are environmental data, right? Mm-hmm. And it's a time series data, means we are logging this data at 1 minute in interval. So these data points are also connected through Pi to the data lake. This is how. Okay. So this is that layer, that L2 layer. From here, then we are taking to the Pi, and from Pi, it will be connected to data lake.
Okay. So that takes care of temperature, RS, delta P. And what about non-variable particle counts, if it covers so that also?
So non-variable particle count details are available in MES. And from MES, then it is connected with the data lake. But from source, I don't think we are taking that data. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Got it. Yeah. Thank you. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Pandey.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Mr. Sarangya. So it was great having your insights, and you answered all the questions. So now moving to the interesting discussion again, I would like to open the floor for the open discussion along with Mr. Shrenik and Mr. Kamaldeep from VCS. The topic, as we all know, is preparing for smart factories for the future, the path to digital transformation. So we have also shared a few points that we would like to highlight during the discussion, and would also like to have your insights on the same. The few pointers that we had mentioned on an email was, how do you overcome threats to profit and safety due to counterfeit in the industry? How do digital traceability help in creating efficiency in plugging gaps in the supply chain? How much the industry is geared to be able to consistently produce a top quality medicine with a complete control on volume? And how is the industry seeking to address newly emerging ecosystems that are constantly changing? So we're going to have insights from all the thought leaders who have joined on these 4 points. And apart from that, we have a few speakers talking about marketing strategies as well, bringing in their expertise. So now first, Shrenik, along with you, I would like to start. And first, I would like to invite Dr. B.M. Rao, Head QA for Emerging Markets, CQC and ASAT from Dr. Reddy's Laboratories. So Dr. B.M. Rao, over to you to share your thoughts.
Good afternoon, everyone. I just have 5 minutes, right? So
share your thoughts, sir. Yes.
Can I share my screen?
Yes, I already have made you a co-host, if I'm not wrong. You want, you can share your screen.
You're able to see the screen?
Yes.
Yeah.
So good afternoon, everyone. So basically what I'm going to talk in next 5 to 7 minutes is, our journey on the, like how we are going to have the pharma quality control lab, more automation through digitalization and automation. So recently I read one very nice article published by McKinsey, the future of the pharma QC lab. Right? So I think this is the one of the slide I liked very well. And in fact, Dr. Eddings, we are working on, in a similar manner, like basically this slide talks about three major horizons of lab evolution. So one is like, what is the digitally enabled labs, then automated labs, and distributed quality control. So here, my discussion is focusing on the quality control labs. Like when we say digitally enabled labs, like for example, at this point of time in the quality control, test execution is mostly 90% testing in the labs, and only some limited testing is done online. In a similar way, for the use of data and advanced technologies, at Dr. Reddy's, we have eliminated a lot of manual paperwork. At least 80% we have, paperless now. So, for example, we have implemented a laboratory information management systems in most of our quality control labs, and also we have done electronic lab notebook in our R&D labs. So with that, we could able to achieve more than 80% paperless. And of course, we are continuously working on the building new capabilities, using the advanced IT systems. Next target is more and more automation in the labs, and future journey towards distribution quality control labs. That means that real time online real time release testing. So if you can As I mentioned, in past few years, we have made a significant progress towards, basically we have done electronic batch records, then we have LIMS. As we have implemented LIMS, we have seen very good benefits, like we eliminated a lot of manual work, we have reduced errors, we can able to get a lot of data, automatically. And when we are being, people who are on this call maybe understand the difficulties and the data required, for doing a lot of investigations. So when we do investigations, it takes a lot of time. So with the data availability through LIMS and all, I think we can definitely, the productivity and the investigation time can be, can be minimized, and we can do the investigations more effectively with the data available online. And do a lot of analysis, we create a lot of data that will be captured through LIMS, and all our chromatographic data systems are connected to LIMS. And then, when we do the verification of the data also, so a lot of manual, interventions and all, we would like to reduce robotic process automation during our chromatographic data systems. This is really helping us in minimizing a lot of manual efforts during data verification. So basically, the robotic process automation helps in for example, in the during FDA inspections, if there are unprocessed chromatograms, any unprocessed sequences or any, missing checks, those things, all these RPA tool is helping us to, check automatically. But in future, I think we also have a lot of plans to use a lot of artificial intelligence tools. We are working on the process analytical technologies, and in future, we will have real-time release testing. This is the one other thing. And so as I mentioned, I think what we have seen is when we have put these LIMS and all, we could see definitely benefits in the chemical QC lab, our costs have been reduced to 25% to 45%, and micro lab to 15% to 30%, we have seen the reduction in the cost. And definitely we have seen a significant improvement in the productivity, and we have seen 80% elimination of the manual work we have seen. And in terms of the some automation in the labs, we have already initiated, especially in the analytical mechatron, included some automation tools. We do the mechatransfers from different, from Hyderabad side to, for example, Vizag side. We do through using some digital technologies, using the, demonstration using the digital technologies. So that we have made some good efforts in that. I think this COVID situation has really prompted us. Earlier, for each and every mechatransfer, people used to travel. That now we have minimized, and mostly even the mechatransfer, the demonstration of the sample preparations, everything through video, and we are doing using some distance. So these are the few things we have implemented, and definitely our company is heavily investing in the digital technologies. And in next 3 to 5 years, our aspiration is to move from now currently digital enabled labs to automated labs, and finally to distributed quality control, wherein 80% to 100% online real time testing, and also review by experts. Thank you so much.
So, thank you, Mr. B.M. Rao, for sharing your thoughts. Ashwanik, do you want to add anything here?
No, I think he's clearly given a roadmap on where they are and where they're going to head to. So I think it's a pretty robust roadmap that they have laid as far as where they are and where technology is going to help them move in the next 3 or 4 years. And as Dr. Rao clearly said, that COVID situation has really helped put the situation in the fifth gear to actually automate a lot of processes at a much faster pace. So I think that's right. Kamal, any input, any thought you have on this?
No, it's a well-presented roadmap which Dr. Rao has shared. I think there is a lot of ground to be covered even now, because the opportunities are huge to automate, to make the things smart, whether that is lab or that is a production process. And the, another thing which is emerging is the convergence. When we look at the process data, quality data, and the environment data together, then there is a lot of production insight and process insight which is getting developed. I think that is the direction which we all are heading to. I think it's very well covered by Sarang and Dr. Rao. Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. B.M. Rao, for being here and sharing your insights. Now, I would request Mr. Krishna Saiti, Associate Vice President, Group Head SAP with Biocon, to share their thoughts on the subject.
Hi, this is Krishna Sai here. So slightly in a different context, I'll be trying to give you, I'm more from an IT background person compared to the other speakers who are more from the quality side of it. While we are in the process of journey now, maybe, we started a bit late compared to other peers, but in general, let's say the Pharma 4.0, what we have been discussing internally and what we are also adopting the digital strategies, which is towards digitizing the pharma manufacturing, which we already know, right? Majority of us, right? It started from, we started primarily digitizing the the quality operations using the QMS systems or your LIMS systems, whatever are there. So it is also talking about, continuous process verification during the process, do continuous process verifications and building analytics, which is coming a bit later. We are still trying to gather the data and trying to build the data lake, like what Sarang has just earlier I explained. But from a different perspective, from an industry per se, when you look at from a pharma industry, like what we are all being here, there is a drastic shift happening slowly towards this pharma 4.0, with obviously industry 4.0 coming in, which has already happened to certain extent in other industries like automobile or FMCG or whatever it is, slightly lagging behind the pharma. Now it is catching up. So we have a, late mover advantage, if I have to say, in the sense we should be able to catch up in all those. For example, in those automotive sector, we saw, where it was primarily a car being there. Now they are using the digital services. They have started using all the, let's say the payments or ecosystems and all that. Like that, now within pharma, there is an ecosystem which is coming out, especially on farm, manufacturing and quality, to build around, let's say the sensor driven, let's say manufacturing operations, for which we are trying to do an POC. Then there is another challenge what we have also faced during this entire journey while it is still in process. Well, majority of us might be knowing, in an API industry, which is more solvent focused, hazardous chemicals and all that, you may not be able to directly get onto any digital device to that matter. You can't take anything to a manufacturing area, and it's obviously, one is it is not allowed, and then it second is it is highly risky, right? So these are the kind of challenges what we face. That's still a challenge. I'm not giving a solution as such for that, which we are still debating, discussing how effectively we should do it to capture the data from the source. That's where the crux of this entire journey is, which we are all going through anyway. Right. Either if we wanted to use a mobile handheld device or, connecting to the DCS SCADA systems. So that's where we are in now. The way what we were also thinking or deliberating, while we have not gone through it, is trying to use your, let's say, like what Dr. Rao said, maybe use an RPA kind of technology using form-based, paper-based, but still convert that to a digital mode using OCR technologies, which do available, which will avoid your data transcription errors and all that. While these are thoughts which are still in very nascent stage, But I would say it's more of, you know, like this digital journey. It has the industry 4.0, while it has given opportunities for us to transit from whatever was the legacy manufacturing to a new manufacturing, but it is coming out with the challenges like what I just now explained. We are in the process of transition and we'll be moving towards that. I think that's what I wanted to say.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir, for your insight. Kamal, Praveen, anyone would like to add to what Mr. Krishna Sai said? I think you've hit the nail. I think everyone is in a journey where people are moving from, and pharma being a very much compliant domain, I think it's very, very critical for all the organizations to have a 25 CFR compliant. That is one of them, but using certain handheld devices, certain mobile phones and everything. So IT plays a very, very important and a crucial role as far as the pharma domain is concerned. At the same time, it is the compliance and security is a huge thing which plays, because it's not just the organization compliance but also the government compliance and everything which are very, very stringent in your domain specifically. So I think very, very crucial that technology becomes a huge enabler for our domain in which we are basically working in, and IT is definitely a game changer in today's world in this. Kamal, anything you would like to add?
I think a lot of things are happening when we are talking about IT. A couple of things have been discussed here. Mr. Krishna Sai has mentioned about OCR technology and all that. You remember that a lot of companies are adopting that in reading the printed data and converting that into database. You have a lot of experience in that, Shranik. In addition to that, there are new things. For example, there is a requirement of certified mobile phones on the shop floor. It means it has to be highly secure. Then there are new technologies of data diodes, which is talking about that no device, no internet should touch the OT system. When we are talking about L1, L2 layer, firewalls and all that is one part of the layer. Still, it is on internet, but there are technology available where the data is transferred from one device to another, but not through Wi-Fi or LAN, and there is a special technology which comes up. So the question is, how do we get IT and OT together and create our future for the pharma industry? I think
that convergence, IT OT convergence is the challenge.
Absolutely, yes.
Yeah.
So thank you, Mr. Krishna Sai, for sharing your thoughts on the subject. Now I would request Mr. Rajendra Dhadich, Senior Vice President, Corporate Quality, from IPCA, to share his thoughts.
Yeah, thank you, Ekta. And at the outset, I must compliment and thank the organizer for this presentation and the discussions. And thanks for this roundtable discussion. As far as how the gentleman said, so late entrant will definitely be having a lot of other advantages. And this current situation of COVID has also enabled us, or rather forced us, that we should start thinking more about this digitalizations. And over and above, if I see your questions and all, I really like all the questions, and especially that how much the industry is geared to be able to consistently produce the top quality medicines with complete control on the volume and all. I think ultimately the automation is going to help us. That is the only thing which can make us to have the product consistency into our product, have the proper validated products, and also not to break the supply chain. In fact, we have been hearing a proverb like, you know, necessity is the mother of invention. And this was written by Sir Plato, but I want to add a factor of the imagination, the way we started imaginating, the way we started thinking that something which has been done on the paper-based thing, why can't it be done on the complete automated platform? So that imagination is important. So in a word, like, the imagination is the father of creativity. And whatever you all gentlemen's industries are doing on this line of the IoT, IoT, like gone are the days when we are talking about the IoT, which is only related to the information technology and the operational excellence. Now it is a complete blend of everything. And nevertheless, I like the slide where Mr. Sarang was talking about the LES and how it LIMS and how it is connected with the Empower. So I think in industry, people have already done a lot related to the quality control laboratory, but to look into the production side, I mean, it is really very important that you get the consistency of the product. And having said pharma industry, I think we are going, pharma industry in India especially is growing in leaps and bounds, and we have exporting several products complete. The world is having the dependability on India. When I say the dependability, gone are the days when we were just manufacturing only those basic generic products or the products with the high concentration of the medicament. Now we are very much into the potent drugs. We are very much into the hormones. We are very much into the life-saving drugs. So definitely we have to have some kind of the consistency in our products so that the entire supply chain should not get disturbed and no batch should go into the failure. So unless the second part, what he prescribed in one of the slides, is complete about the laboratory and second side is all about the production. If that is being done with various solutions, IIoT-based solution, 4.0-based solutions, then I think we'll be having a wonderful story of the pharmaceutical pharma fraternity getting into the export business. So I think that's all from my side, and I really enjoyed the presentation. It's really, really very good. Thanks for the thanks to all for this wonderful presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rajendra.
Thank you, Mr. Rajendra. I think you touched upon a very important aspect, which is supply chain. I think that also is a very, very crucial and important aspect in any of the domains and any vertical, but specifically in the pharma space. The COVID times really tested everyone. And I think in those times, the kind of solutions we also came up with a lot of customers and everything really helped the customers to improve the supply chain from the manufacturer to actually the retailer. When you talk about two verticals which were really only functioning when the lockdowns were happening was the chemist and the retail kirana stores, and supply chain during those times was really disrupted because of a lot of aspects related to the government approvals and everything. And those times, I think a lot of customers also came to us, a lot of pharma customers, a lot of other customers also came to us saying that, come, let's think about some innovative solutions, what we can do. And we came up with certain things which really helped the customers, certain apps which could actually help them track how things are moving from one location to another location. And supply chain today, if I have to look at it, is the heartbeat for any organization today. And in these times, that has really transpired a lot of organizations to take huge steps to improve the supply chain. And that is really, the COVID times have really taught a lot of organizations that one, supply chain was not an important aspect of the organization, which has become the core of the organization today. So that's it.
You have nailed it. And I think we being into the essential pharma, so like from IPCA, when I'm saying everything, we were continuously working. So management has taken a lot of efforts. I think the same thing is with the Unichem, Dr. Reddy's and Lupin and all other my friends are there. So perhaps you all know that after when Trump announced about the hydroxychloroquine sulfate and those chloroquine molecules, so the supply chain has become such an important thing for us, that all the plants were having one of the other government personnel so that they can put a radar kind of the thing, how the things are moving. And at the same time to arrange right from the raw material intermediate N-1, N-2, and going back to the packaging component, supply chain came out like a big, big, big role. And suddenly in that 1 year, of course, supply chain is indeed playing a big role, but it has surfaced out, I don't know what word to use, very prominently during this time. So I think and losing one single batch is going to make every entire program getting disturbed. And I like the word of Dr. Rao when he says the real-time releasing facility. So once your job is done over here, within no time, you should be able to release the batch. We sitting over here, all quality assurance personnel would definitely love that. We should not be spending a lot of time in the reviewing each and every audit trail, rather start getting those signals from those riders, what system is going to give me. So I think that way it's really going to help us. And supply chain, sir, you rightly said, Mr. Srenik, that that is extremely, extremely important in nowadays. Thank you.
Yeah, I think two functions which were really, really on their toes was supply chain and IT. So Krishna, I also can basically say, I think, and still IT continues to be on the toes today, as along with supply chain.
Indeed, indeed. IT has entered into every department nowadays.
Kamal, Kamal, anything you would like to add on and top it up with your experience?
No, I like the word imagination which Mr. Rajendra initiated or introduced to the team. Because what happens is there are one type of challenges, it's engineering challenges. What Nitesh initially talked about, that how do we connect the source system? So while working with OSIsoft 5, we have seen the system has more than 500 connectors. So it can connect with various protocols and all that. So engineering challenges are getting solved by that. But once you have the data with you, whether that is environment data, process data, quality data, what you do with the data, that is where the imagination comes. What are the use cases? What Sarang mentioned when we started discussing, and Sarang and Srihari and all sitting together, that what can we do with this data? What are the use cases? Slowly, slowly things emerge that, okay, let's look at what are the bad tablets. Let's look at OE. Let's look at golden tunnel. So once you have a single source of truth, I think a lot of things can be done on that. That is left only to imagination. So that's very nice thing which you have introduced, Mr. Rajendra.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks. Thanks, Kamal.
Thank you, Mr. Rajendra, for sharing your thoughts. Now, Shranik, I would like to invite Dr. Pramod R. Rajput, the vertical head and senior VP with Kerala Pharmaceuticals. But he's going to get a different perspective because his expertise is mostly from marketing. So over to you, doctor, to share your thoughts on your expertise.
Thank you. Thank you, Ekta ji, and good evening to all the wonderful people here. So I was learning, actually, right? So when the people we are talking about manufacturing, supply chain, IT, so we are the people who sell the things. Right. And what you said is very, very clear, that supply chain has become an integral part, because in any organization, it was very clear that the product should be reaching to the last man, to the society. And that was the reason supply chain has been always, everybody saying that how the supplies have been made during the COVID time. And IT has played a role everywhere, including the HR. Now the people, they are not only talking about the bell curve, they are talking about so many different ways how you are going to put the things in that. So now such a beautiful discussion. But here I like to also add, which is in terms of the marketing and sales, because I take care for the marketing and sales. We have to have this innovative mindset, which is very important, because now this COVID has changed the complete innovative mindset. And at the same time, it has to be aligned with the talent and the culture. What we have the talent, because every person in the sales and marketing, they have the talent and what the ambitions of the organization is. And every organization has done the thing. That is the reason we are seeing that in spite of the COVID and all, now the double digit growth has come. So that is the beauty of the coming up, the new molecule, new thing, is strengthening the things and all. Then the agility has increased. Because why I talk about the agility, you all will agree, in your domain also, and in our domain also, because we have made it the phygital. Phygital means, you know, the person has to go and meet the doctor. At the same time, person has to do the mobile working also, and lot many things are there. So the phygital part, agility has been increased. Then third thing is that alignment. Because this COVID has taught us how we can align with all the different departments very well. So the respect of all the department, that's why I said the supply chain, respect of all the department has grown up in a very, very high level. Now we are able to feel that all the departments are equally important, right? It should not be only the sales and marketing should be running towards one side and other people should be sided. So we know that all the departments can help, including the SFE also, because when the data is not there, data analytics are not there, we are not able to understand that how the things are happening and all. So this is a wonderful blend of the things. So the question which Ekta ji has sent to me, this is very, very important, because it was there on the, how do you overcome the threats to profits and safety due to counterfeit industry? It's very common. Either it is Quinolone from this, from Ipca, or whatever the other drugs are there and all, we have the brand AC-Lock and all. We have to have what we are thinking, what we have done, we have made the hologram part. And it has to be changed like that, because there are a lot of spurious drugs are coming, and with a QR code. So we are informing to the people, we are giving the things, we are putting in the Facebook, we are putting in all, these are things are there, this is the right drug which is available. Second thing is, here we keep on requesting that the legal system has to be very, very clear. Legal system takes a lot of the time. By the time that spurious drug or the duplicate drugs come, it gets over the one batch and all, nothing happens and all. So the legal system has to be modernized and it has to be further integrated, that the immediate action should come in a 1 month of time or maximum 2 months of time. By that time it goes right. So this is one thing which we can help, and we are putting our effort also, because we all have, because when we talk about the DRL, we are talking about the IPCA, we all have the drug which is more than 100 crore, at least one or two or three brands are there. It's very, very important as a group. Biocon also, we have the different type of drugs and all. Right, so this is one thing. Second thing is, which I'm coming about, that how we are going to take care for the supply part. Because see, the GPS enability is very important. Why we talk about the GPS enability? Lot of influences is happening. When the truck is moving and all, when it reaches to the some other place, we don't understand that how come that influence has happened. What are the things are there? Transporter is telling us it will take 3 days of the time to reach, right? It takes 5 days of the time. Probably they are not dispatching the thing. Somewhere it's getting stuck up. So if we have, like the way we track our people when they are working through the GPS, that where, which call they have done, where they are working, which area they are working, if something can be enabled, I think it is going to help us a lot. This is the second point which I like to have. The third point is the talent pool. We have a very beautiful talent pool, and that is the reason we have changed the entire thing. Like, you know, we have the vaccine which has been developed. We are able to provide to the world. Earlier we used to take the thing. So that the talent pool can going to give lot many things. Now we are working about the new thing, which is the genetics, genomes, life cycle management and all. So this is the another thing which we for personally feel as a Indian pharmaceutical company, purely Indian pharma, we are able to provide to the entire world, which is there. And today I'm very happy that all the eminent people from the legend companies, big companies, they are sitting here, and we all have the beautiful talent pool, because we are the master in our particular segment, and we are able to provide this to the entire world. Either it is any of the company, from Biocon to DRL to Cadila, whatever it is like that. Then the last point is that how the bodies they are going to help. See, I was attending one of the meeting in FSSI, right? It is not a directly domain here. But they are also strengthening. They used to take 1 year of time to take the decision. I was talking to my friend who is the managing director, the MD of FSSI, Dr. Shobhit Jain. Right? He said that government has tightened up that in 3 months of time, we should give the clearance. So it means that government is also coming up. Same way we have the different domains like OPPI is there, IDMA is there and all. So if you are going to put the things in that way and we collaborate the things together, I think the decision will be much faster, much better, and it will be on the win-win situation on every cases. So this is the thing which I like to highlight, and we are putting it also, we are talking to the people also, and as the industry professionals with the marketing people, with the other people, we are associating also, so that we should get a better output to take care to elevate the human suffering. So this is from my side.
Thank you, Dr. Rajput. First, I would like to say that you've been in sales and marketing. I also had the sales and marketing, so it's a very, very touching subject. I think we've also ran through our own set of challenges during that time. But one thing which is coming out from this particular event is, I'm trying to pick up one words, and the one word which Dr. Rajendra said was about supply chain. What you said was respect for all functions. So as you rightly said, when we were all working from office, that respect was never coming up against department. But today, when everyone ran through the respective challenges and personal challenges everyone went through, what I could see was everyone stood by the respective functions. They extended their arms to that thing. They went above their jobs and ensured that they were supporting each other functions. And everyone realized that every function is so valuable in the organization. And that's how today, when we are talking about the COVID time, still lockdowns happening, some in minimum states and everything, businesses have actually started moving in. I'm not saying it's at pre-COVID levels, but yes, businesses started moving in. As you rightly said, everyone is coming up with innovative ways in sales and marketing. As you rightly said, we had to really think through how we can improve our sales, at least not a decline, but we can meet our regular levels of whatever sales we're doing to ensure that the profitability of the organization is managed and everything. As you rightly said, costs were going up in supply chain, GPS enabled technology. So what we've also done for all of our customers is we've enabled multiple GPS providers, and the trucks are actually monitored through geofencing and everything. And as you rightly said, we say it's going to take 2 days and it actually takes 5 days. But what we have done is we've broken those shackles by giving the right kind of technology where the sales guy does not need to call up supply chain, truck nikla, nahi nikla, kidhar hai. He can actually get into the app, actually see it, and then call the customer directly and say that your truck is going to actually be reaching on so-and-so day and so-and-so time. And once they reach, how do you basically enable it? Provide an OTP kind of a solution where you confirm that customer has received the goods. So as you rightly said, sales marketing is all about innovation. Rajendra said about imagination, supply chain. So I think one words which are coming up, we are actually joining in and creating our own supply chain as far as technology is concerned. Krishna Sai talked about IT, supply chain, respect for each department. I think those are very, very important aspects. And value of people is realized by every single individual in these times. So that is what I would like to add. Kamal, your thoughts on technology front on this?
Yeah, I just want to add one or two more things in this. One is, I think COVID also has created some challenges for all of us, and we are trying to think differently. We were not thinking on these lines earlier, probably to some extent, or there may be some hurdles, bottlenecks, whatever the reasons. Now we are coming out with new things. This is very interesting because we were talking to MSN in Hyderabad, and they were doing Salesforce reporting, for example, field force reporting only for the domestic medical representative. But during this time, they have implemented that for all their international sales because the traveling was limited. People can't go there in different countries. So they come across information security challenges, language challenges, and now they have a unified system which their international salespeople and domestic salespeople are using. Same thing I can think of, for example, Serum. Serum wanted a stock and sales statement. Earlier, medical rep used to go in the field, get the document, mail, or get a email, or etc. But they introduce a OCR-based system. Now they are getting it through an imagery, and the data directly goes to database. So COVID also is pushing us for innovations, as everyone is realizing. I think that's a very interesting phase which you're in. Thank you.
I just want to say, because now technology has told that technology is the god, right? And we say, yeah, that is the god. Content is the king, and data is the new oil for oil. The data. That is the real
data is thing. New oil.
New oil. And what you said, Kamal Saab, is very clear. You'll not believe, not many companies, I'm sure, we all have celebrated the star function on the digital, right? So a lot many things which we have added this part, which has really added the thing. Same thing what you're saying, that the organization has taken the entire stock statement. So we have also channelized the thing. So sitting here, the IT department, every day it gives us that where the things are there, what are the things are there, how it has to be replenished. Because in some places, the remote people are not able to go there, not able to take their things. So we understand their things, and then we channelize the thing. So there should not be any particular gap between this. So what you said, correct, 100%. I fully resonate with you.
Thank you.
If I can add on, Samik, I think I could resist from this talk, you know, because I am a lawyer. You know, you'll find me in a very different forum here. I'm not technically, you know, competent like you all, but, you know, it's very enriching from the, you know, presentation and other talk. But, you know, from my point of view, what Dr. Rajput said and Kamal also said, that it's very, very, you know, apt, and we all definitely understood that we always talk change, you know, change is difficult, change management, a lot of works have happened. Now, without anything, you see the whole world has gone through such a huge change in their personal and professional life. And it's amazing. And we are still, you know, all the COVID survivors, you know, no need for training on the change management going forward. You know, that's such a huge, you know, change. If you see the fraternity, it's, you know, as you said, we are moving from, you know, quality production to slowly to IT, then marketing, and also legal. If you see the changes, can anybody, particularly India, would have thought of having a court process or court hearing through digital mode? I'm sitting at my home, you know, maybe sometime back, I was attending a court, you know, case, litigious, imagine the lawyer is from his home. The opponent lawyer, my lawyer, you know, and my client is in another place. Imagine how it's happening. eight people, six people in their comfort of their home at in a very, you know, way, whether it is raining or outside lockdown, irrespective of that, the show must go on. As you said, you know, it's going on. Court process still, you know, functioning. May not be that apt, like, you know, the physical, you know, way, but, you know, it's a process. And slowly people are adapting to that. The other, you know, critical point I would bring, if you want to take a keyword of something like the flexibility and, you know, your mindset for change. This again, the you know, COVID pushed us definitely, I believe, 5 years ahead in terms of technology. Where you would have in 20, 25, 26, we are today there. Kids are learning, you know, my son is studying in different, you know, room, he's, you know, academy. I'm into this, or somebody, you know, watching some cooking show or something, you know, in a different, you know, forum. So what all happening is, at the same time, from the comfort of our home, without damaging the environment, saving a lot of time, pollution, traffic, all that, we are getting that time and, you know, we are at least in a peace way to think of something better. And it is happening every day if you see. These all apps were there. You know, I worked in multinational companies in a particular pharma sector for over 12 years out of my 20-year experience. I can correlate two, three things what, you know, Sanix was telling, that one transport. I remember some, you know, a decade back in from one of our, you know, plant, one truck started carrying medicine. It has never reached its destination. And we are talking of counterfeit product. You know, imagine. It's, you know, we put our all effort, except obviously GPS was probably not that active 10 years back. WhatsApp and all these things. So typically it never reached the destination. We could, you know, figure out penalty, insurance, indemnification, all those done, legal side compliant. But where are those material? Where are those products gone? You know, like that, you know, used to happen. Today, if you think of, I think with technology, we can at least get escape from those kind of incidents if we are little bit alert. Another example, if I say again, you know, personal life, that while working in one of the, you know, corporate, there was an intercompany transfer. So when the transfer, you know, came, I was the first to kind of saying, you know, why this? Because always, as you know, kids, school, your own house, a location, you are comfortable. When you have to change that city, I was saying, why can't we work from here? It's the same company, you know, a different location only. No, no, all people are moving. So your team is moving there. This will help, you know, to work together under one roof. Imagine within the same company, whether in, you know, Bombay or Delhi or, you know, Bangalore, in whichever location you are, versus that was a resistance that time, that people have to transfer and some people really moved without their willingness to the different city. And today what's happening, how we are working for last over 1 year. So, you know, where are those thoughts, you know, gone? And it is absolutely possible. The management can control from across the sea, from, you know, different part of the world, the whole operation in India. And, you know, Indian team, if you talk about one location, one office, you should sit next to my Kevin only. It is like that. You know, I want to see you, or if the moment I call, you are there. That, you know, mindset need to change. The last thing on technology front, I would say, we, you know, most of the companies in my knowledge today, they are willing to spend. They want to automate because COVID again, you know, taught them. Everybody was working from home. We all can do the work stuff from, you know, home. As a lawyer, I can sit at home and work, and many senior can work. What about the plant? Plant people had to go through. Imagine last year, May, June, when it was very difficult, they really put their life at risk. They were going to the plant, a lot of compliance challenges, transportation, canteen, huge restriction. Still, they were managed to work. So there the learning is, if you would have given a more technological advancement, at least some of more people you would have saved. You know, many people lost their life in that process and organization also felt bad about it. But what to do there if they are not technologically upgraded? You need to depend on manpower and you know that. So that's where the mindset should be, you know, when we do something, it should be highly futuristic compared to, you know, a short-term gain or, you know, some saving. It should be for a forward-looking, and when we start something, the golden, you know, saying, say, you should think of the end while starting something. And I always believe, you know, anything is possible. That's my favorite quote. And I go with that, that this has really taught us a lot more than what we could have, you know, otherwise learned. Even by nature, just one small, you know, virus, and you see what all changes happen. So that's what I would overall summarize, you know, on the change management need of the hour, flexibility, and how we can adapt to the technology and look for the more and more automation and taking the right tool at the right time, so that, you know, rest all, I think you can talk about the serialization, the various coding, and lots of you know, implementation, you all are, you know, great, you know, expert in your field. That's what I thought. I mean, from a completely different perspective, I'll add, being a, you know, lawyer and company secretary. So I've been in the boardroom and I've seen the top management decision making and the thought process. That's where these are my learning, that how still they're, you know, thinking. If somebody is working from home, the mindset till before the COVID was like, probably the guy is not working. Probably he may be sleeping, he is enjoying. If the phone ring, he's not taking the call. It's, you know, it, they're not assuming that even in office also it can happen. He may not take your call or she may not be, you know, on the desk. But that's the mindset. But you see today how the work from home is serving. It's a great, great, I think, opportunity for all the ladies, all the, you know, people from remote place to just give it the balance of all the tier two, tier three cities, village, you know, development, because people are there, you know, in their own house. From there, they're working rather than in a city paying huge rent, commuting, traffic, all of those, you know, challenges. So that's all, I think, from a process point of view, improvement and the cost saving we can bring. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Raghunath.
So actually, I was about to introduce the audience. This was Mr. Raghunath Rath. He's a senior legal counsel and company secretary with Elcon Laboratories, who just shared his thought. So anything, Shrenik, you want to add on this?
I think he's covered a lot of stuff, and from a legal point of view, and as he rightly said, that the top management in the initial days obviously had that mindset in a lot of organizations, whether the guy is actually working or not. And that is a phenomena in the initial days of COVID, where a lot of management and managers had the mindset that whether the guy at home is working or not. But I think in the last 1 year, I think a lot of things have changed. I think people have got really used to the work environment. And I think the next thing going to come from, are we comfortable working from office? That's the next question which is going to come up after 6 months or so. So that is the next thing, which is definitely a question which everyone is asking to each other. Yeah, office chalu hoga, are we going to be comfortable working from office? I think we had a lot of comfort working from home, I think. And I think when we talk about productivity and everything, yeah, initial days, everyone had a challenge in giving the right kind of productivity when they were working from home. But I think as things moved, as things progressed and people realized it, I think the productivity of people have increased. I think more and more seriousness has come in as far as working is concerned. Yeah, the tough job for Dr. Rajput and me when we are into sales and marketing is not meeting customers physically. When we meet customers physically, the value creation is definitely much more when we do it virtually. So that's the limitation that we have, or a drawback, or no doubt we have technologies, but talking to a customer for a 1 crore deal virtually and physically talking makes a lot of difference. So that's certain shortcomings which are there, but rest of the functions, rest of the stuff, definitely the faith also by the management has come into people that yes, people are going to work, people are going to deliver now. And people also have realized that there is no second alternative to what work from home is going to here to stay. Hybrid working is going to be there, but work from home is going to stay. So people, management should have faith in the people. And give some freedom to the people. I'm sure they will deliver. Yes. So that's the only thing I would like to add as 2 cents of mine to what Mr. Raghunath said.
So I just want to add, Ekta ma'am, with your permission.
Yes, of course.
So Shrenik sir said it is correct. See, the sales is like an emotional connect. And that is the reason that digital both is going to work, right? Because we sell the emotions. And then only the things come, because every company produces the same thing. Every company has a beautiful quality. Every company is talking about the cost effectiveness, right? But the emotional connects makes the things different. And that is the reason in sales line, this is very, very, very important what you said. You have touched the fulcrum of the entire thing.
So on a very light note, don't take me in a very personal thing. I would say that I always give an example to a lot of my sales guys that when you go and get married, first the boy and girl meet. So when someone goes to meet the customer, it is you who are representing the organization's marriage is happening at the later date. When you talk about organization giving order to someone, they are giving order on your credibility.
Correct.
Organizations definitely is a backing, because which organization you present. So it's about when you go to see a girl when your marriage times, if the boy and the girl first meet, the parents actually meet, it's a formality to be, ha yaar, ghar barabar hai, ye barabar hai, educated hai, theek hai, chalo abhi. So on a lighter note,
you're right.
People buy from people. People buy from people.
Yeah, correct.
And the eye contact, the shake hand, when you do physical sales, make a lot of difference. So that's my add-on to this. So yeah, Ekta.
Here I want, one negative thing only has come, which is very important. I think I'm sure many companies would have taken the emotional agility. There was a gap there, right? So that is the reason some people, they felt it that yes, this is not means fair. So I have seen the people suffering with some of the mental disability and some of the things are there. So let me just add here. So we did lot many workshops also for the families, because it is not that people have a big 4 BHK house or 3 BHK. There are the people, families, they are there in 1 BHK also, right? In Bombay, like lot many field people and all in big places, they have a single 1 BHK. And 3, 4, 5, 6 people are there, you know, they have to have the things and all. So we added that thing that yes, some psychologist and psychiatrist or from BK Shivani madam, somebody should come and speak about the things, which has really added value. So people, they felt, chalo abhi jo hai thoda halke ho gaye, right? Something good has come. So these all things have added positive things and all. Thank you from my side.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Raj.
Thank you so much. So now I would like to invite Mr. Verma DVS. He is the Associate Vice President, Corporate Quality Assurance with Sai Life Sciences Limited. Mr. Verma, your thoughts, please. You need to unmute, yeah.
You're on mute.
Yes, Mr. Verma, you just unmute yourself. Is there an issue? You can re-log in, try re-logging in. Yeah, maybe some.
You can request someone else to take till
yes.
basically log in.
So Mr. Verma will re-log in. Meanwhile, I would like to have Mr. Shaligram Rani, Vice President and Site Head Quality with Lupin, to share his thoughts. So Mr. Rani, over to you.
Sure, thank you. It was a nice session from everyone, and I learned a lot of things. Like Dr. Rajput also said, this is a learning, and there is no end for the learning. I have been working in the pharma industry from the last 30 years, but there is no end. And believe me, this COVID situation like taught us like many things, as someone also mentioned that we are ahead about the 5 years or 6 years. Yes, that is very true. Because I think this 4.0 started somewhere in 2015, but still nobody knows or well known about this 4.0. So I think because of this COVID situation, everyone is actually behind with the IT. And just to share, because I think everyone has shared a lot of good experience and the reality. So in addition to that, from the IT front, when I work in quality control somewhere about in the 1990s, so that time I used the manual HPLC, and I have to inject every sample on the HPLC. But after that, there is automation, and then you have to put the vial in the HPLC and you will get the result on the next day. The similar way the situation comes. So like during the COVID situation, we learn the many things. So specifically, I would like to share my experience about the virtual audit. Because, you know, as per the quality assurance system, we have to follow the certain norms as per our defined quality system. And a vendor has to qualify it. Basically, when we introduce any new vendor, so that time when we introduce any vendor, so that time we have to audit, we have to go to the facility, we have to audit this, we have to make the report. And everything was done through virtually. And believe me, in at Lupin, like corporate quality department as well as the site quality, completed more than 50 audits in this year itself. So which gives the supply chain also was very happy with us that earlier it took around 2 years or 3 years for the approval, because we have to go, we have to plan the site visit. But now because of this technology revolution, probably we could able to complete our tasks in very faster way. The same thing like most of the Mumbaikers specifically working from home. And as explained by many people, like supply chain, specifically the all the supply chain handled by our HO guys, and they handle very well. And with the communication with the quality guys to release the material on time, the simultaneously as I'm working in the a biotech industry like this GPS, like when we transport the material, so that time you are tracking the system in a similar way. Now we are tracking the temperature monitoring system also online, so that there is no problem at all during the transportation. So like there are many more benefits we actually got from this COVID situation. And I think the quality, really, at least the quality department is happy. The other thing, this is one part, like we audited the many sites. The similar way, the few agencies, like specifically this EMA, then Japanese, then TGA. So many agency audited our facility virtually. And every time we actually face the many more problems, but we actually with the help of again IT, because you know earlier hardly two or three members available at the site for the IT just to manage. And what they do earlier, they just do manage the only the laptop me a problem, a o problem, that's it, nothing. But nowadays I think there is an equal importance to the quality assurance as well as to the IT department, because in the past we actually invited one of the agency, one of the a consultant from US, and he spent around 65% in the IT department only. And he listed many more things, even that was the eye opener for the Lupin, at least. These are the like many gaps we identified, and that's the revolution comes. But because of this COVID situation, I think there is a lot of importance to the IT department now. And everywhere, like a CSV, computer validation, then whenever we have this LIMS or MES, then we have to actually align all together, then integration. There's many more teams come up, but because of this technology, I think we could able to achieve every target. And the last one, if you see the market, global market, even in the last year, it was collapsed. And if I talk about this specifically to the Indian market, so last year, the Sensex was around 40K. And now if you see today, it is around 55K. So it gives, even in the difficult situation, we can achieve the 20% high, which was not achieved at all in the 1 year. If you see the history of the market, we never achieved. But you name the company, every company actually have like a 20% or 30%. Because of that contribution, ultimately, the global market up by 20 to 30%, whether you name NASDAQ or Dow Jones, everywhere. So I think it's a great learning for me from this, and specifically thanks Dr. Reddy's for the real case. And really Lupin will also really think about, because currently we have the many more software like EDMS, then QMS, then L2LMS, means many more things again we have to integrate together. But I think this is the right way to have the one software, so that we can actually use that particular time. And someone actually also mentioned, even Dr. Rao also mentioned about the investigation. So when we investigate, when there is any OS, of course there is a pressure from the supply chain, we have to release this material by today or tomorrow. But if we found the OS, because of that one OS, we have to hold the other batches, because that OS happened in the same sequence, in the same HPLC sequence. So unless and until we complete that investigation, it is not possible. Now, the data-driven activity definitely will improve and will save over a lot of times. So I think this is a good forum, and this is an eye-opener for everyone. And thanks all leaders for sharing your experience. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Shaliga. Kamal, you would like to add something?
I have a quick question for Mr. Rane and maybe other people. The question which is coming to my mind is, we all understand this is a very mission critical journey which we are taking in digital transformation. Who should be driving this? Is it the IT who should be driving? Is it the quality? Because we are talking about investigation, shortening the time, getting the real time data at one place so that it is available to all. So is it the manufacturing people, they should be leading that initiative in the organization, or should it be IT, or should it be quality, or there has to be a separate digital? I mean, how does it work in your organization, for example, if Mr. Rane, you can tell us.
See, in our organization, we have the corporate IT department who drives this IT related. But site quality is actually supporting, and of course the manufacturing, but mostly this is a corporate IT department drive this entire project.
Just to add there, you know, being from IT, I can just add from a different perspective, it would, so just that, you know, whomsoever we have the representation, you know, barring me, I think majority of them are from the function. So the way it would work, or the way we have seen, is obviously driven from the function. Maybe we can call that as a digital team or a digital solution team, which we are also calling. It is a combination of technology and the function. I think that is where it would work, and that is proven already, starting from your earlier ERP implementations to now. Everywhere there should be some middle team which will work with core technology and the business. So that is how it would be a success, is what I feel.
Yeah, even I want to add one point here regarding IT, because see, we are moving from commercial to techno commercial. Okay, when we say advancement, it is not only the regulatory and production what is taking into picture, it's more of now integrated IT system. I would like to share one example here. In one of our audit here, we were discussing on the SAP validation. And you know, when it comes to validation, qualification is always driven by QA, and expectation in past was only like QA should explain this. But that regulators were like keen to see what IT's role was there. And he was expecting IT to explain more of regulatory in terms of how technology is in terms. So we should be in an aligned way, meaning we should train our IT guys, because I have seen over the past, IT means they are just a support function for some this, but they should be knowing what are those requirements, from where this is started, and how companies are getting different warning letters, 483s. Basically, if you see 50% of the warning letter 483s are, most of these are related to data integrity. Yeah, and then when we say data integrity, the 80% of the thing is with IT, and remaining 20% people who handles it. But IT should be knowing what are those core functions of data integrity when it comes to regulatory expectation. So we should get tune our IT team in a quality environment. That is the stage we have reached now. That's what I want to add here.
That's exactly correct, Nitish.
Thank you.
Not only that, if you see, even QA people should train on IT perspective. Because tomorrow, yes, we have to have hand-to-hand in handling the audits, which is a key for us, actually.
Yeah, to be very frank, we in our organization, we have taken one person from IT, one person from engineering, who are actually an engineer and IT professional in background, but they are working as a quality assurance. So they are gelled with QA culture. That's the reason we are holding them responsible as a QA. And when it comes to audit and this, they are the frontline with our IT and engineering team to be there as a QA, not a pharmacist.
Right, that's right. Friendly. I just also want to add here, as Mr. Shaligram said and Nitesh said, 60% of the time, these regulators are nowadays spending with the IT guy. And not only that, I think IT has learned a lot of terminology, what we have been talking in the quality control laboratory or quality assurance. So the same with the quality assurance and quality control personnel, they have understood about the complete backup, how the backup has to be done, and how the integration parameters. IT guys is knowing that. So I think it's a good blend between the IT and the quality team, and that was indeed needed. So this technology has grown like anything. And IT's role has, extended further to almost every department. Like, the automation is not only limited to the quality control. Of course, it started more with the quality control, but now everywhere in the production and also for the environmental monitoring. So everywhere, so IT baked person is there in each department. So the same person having a knowledge of the other departments, but baked with some kind of the IT kind of the knowledge. Even companies are also planning some kind of the programs, training programs for the people to know more of the IT. Like, we used to have the finance for non-finance. Like, similarly, we have a courses like IT for non-IT guys, so that at any given point of time, they should not do something, because most of the time, my colleague said that some people like FD observation related to the data integrity, but some of the majority of the time that nobody is doing that integrity, but unanonymously, erroneously, or without having the proper knowledge of those features of the program, they do this. In the beginning, Sarang said about that compression machine when he was showing the presentation, and he talks about the compression force. So several 51 attributes are there in the compression force. Now, which 51 has to put, what should be the limit? What are the logical digits? 0, 1, every time 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1. So person gets confused. So these information, so kind of the training was also imparted to the people in the quality department so that they understand what is this IT and the vice versa. So I think this blend has enriched the knowledge overall in the pharma industry. That's from my side.
Yes,
yeah.
Thank you so much.
Just if you can add, if I can add a couple of minutes on this very interesting IT store.
Yes.
So what happened, I mean, I remember we were about to have a board meeting. We entered the boardroom, the VC has to open. So 10 minutes before time we reach there, which normally in course is okay, good time. We are not able to, you know, get through that VC. We are not able to make it on. The director started coming to the room, 2-3 minutes to like 5-7 minutes ice level. Then we called the IT. One person, he was looking for the IT manual, because there is a manual for everything nowadays. How to run the VC, there is a manual. Some guy has taken that manual out from the meeting room. Now it's not there. We are tracing where is the manual book. Now even the IT person doesn't know how to switch on the VC. He's looking for a manual. We thought he's our mind. You know, he should tell us. He's saying, no, the manual came from global. It was there. We called the IT head because it was a critical. So I kept everyone on backup. The IT head, the vice president came into the room. When we ask, can you switch on the VC? He's like this stretching his head saying, you know, sorry, man, I really don't know. I have to call his junior. We said he already came and he failed. You know, this is what happened when, you know, there are different people in the IT, because most of the point I'm telling is IT function is outsourced in most of the function, you know, most of the corporate. So there will be one or two very limited resource in house, then they do outsource to somebody. And then this company, the transition, the people turn around is little more, you know, they change frequently. Either the guy leave the job or some, you know, new agency come in, some new, you know, SAP vendor or something. So those lot of changes happen behind, and those people are not really trained. They come and they do like a firefighting mode always, you know, whenever there is a war. So you don't get that. In that way, you can also achieve it through trial and error method. Then in the same organization, this is one experience. Later, we saw in various key, you know, business meetings, US FDA preparedness, you know, audit before the meeting, we will see the IT guys spending huge amount of hours there. That is when this guy will come and say, you are asking me IT, I forgot everything about basic IT. Now I'm into business, into quality, and the audit. That is my core KRA now has changed. So that's what actually a real, you know, change happened, which is, I think, the probably need of the hour, but I think the basic also they should not leave it, you know, or forget it. So now I've seen the transition in the IT's role, and the scope has widened. Now I think obviously with the work from home culture and most of the things are automated. So IT is not only that plug and play or laptop or iPhone installer, all those activity. They do a lot of things which really, I mean, I don't understand. And you know, it's how that, you know, work. Yeah.
So just to add, I think what we've also seen, the buying behavior, what it was earlier and today, I think earlier it was IT who used to take certain decisions on the application or whatever. In the recent time, we've seen that organizations have started forming a committee. So IT is one of them, business is another one, quality compliance, manufacturing head, and everything all coming together as it's not about someone knowing the technology, because technology has enhanced so much. There is a tectonic shift to the kind of new technologies coming every day, and it's very, very difficult for an individual to keep pace to that particular thing. So a committee definitely plays an important role, because IT definitely understands the technology and the application part of it. From the business user point of view, it is very, very important that what are the use cases, what are the real scenarios. When we go and say that, when you go and buy a car, you say that, okay, you're going to get an average of 18. That's an ideal scenario. Idealistic condition is 18, but when you actually get the car on the road, you're going to get an average of 12 or 13. So what happens is earlier IT used to take a decision, but certain business scenarios were missed out and certain things, key components were missed out. But now being a committee lot of functions coming together. The way the technology is getting implemented definitely has changed, and that is creating more value to the organization. So that's what our experience has been in the recent times, that a committee is actually formed where different functions come together. IT definitely is a driver to it, but an input is taken from all the functions.
Yeah. So thank you, Shrenik, and thank you, Mr. Nakul, everyone sharing your thoughts. So we have two speakers left, Mr. Nitesh and Mr. Verma, to share their thoughts on. So Mr. Verma, since you are not audible, so I would like to have your insights, and then we move on to Mr. Nitesh. Yes? So yes, please, Mr. Verma, over to you.
Thank you so much, Ekta, and good evening, everyone. I'm working in Sai Life Sciences, where we are a basic CDMO player, and being CDMO player for us, actually the client satisfaction is the utmost priority. In terms of digitalization, what we are doing, we are taking into consideration all the functions, starting from the business development, where we have implemented the Salesforce, then in the program management, where we have started implementation of operations oversight module, wherein the we call it as project workbench. This will enable the seamless coordination between the teams, and the program management can provide the real time reporting to the clients on the project execution. And subsequent to that, there are a couple of functions, SCM as well as the PPIC. For them, we have created another application on a cloud hosted platform. It is basically to consolidate the view of inventories across, and which enable SCM to start ordering the materials. Not only that, even the batch planning and everything, PPIC, it enables PPIC to have the batch planning in the right time, and do it in a smooth way. And subsequent to that, when it comes to the drug discovery of our startup of our business process, where we are handling the drug discovery, there we've implemented Discovery Studio. And similarly, there are other platforms like deep learning, lead compound screening, other various applications from the drug discovery. Not only that, we also started implementation of electronic lab notebook from discovery, drug discovery, and extended this to the process development, so that whatever the experimentation the people are doing from a discovery, then the process, we are entering into the electronic lab notebook, where we started capturing the data, the start point in a molecule life cycle. And from there, we are also introducing various PAT tools in the process engineering studies while the development of a molecule. And subsequent to that, what we did is, we have created one particular application where it is a unique application in the manufacturing site, where it covers all the six quality systems, starting from the material management, your facilities and equipment, then material, quality management system, production controls, and laboratory controls, as well as your packaging and labeling. Where this is a unique application where we are capturing the entire data, starting from the material received at the manufacturing site, and also the pre-inspection process during the receipt, and subsequently an auto sample will be placed in the quality control module to pick up that sample. And from there, we have integrated this part with the LIMS. How we did is, this particular application we have integrated with the LIMS through a chromatographic data system, where we have created a grabber to pick up the data from chromatographic system, and that will flow into our manufacturing system. We call it as this is called GMP Pro, where we can get the data, and there will be auto calculation built in the system. So we have avoided the complete manual intervention in the quality control lab. This is how we have implemented this. And this entire data, what we are doing is, this is being integrated with all the other modules, what I've said, with the program management, with the SCM and PPIC. So this is how the initial phase of this digitalization we are working on, where we are generating the data. Then next level would be our the implementation of the data analytics and subsequent AI tools establishment. This will be taken care over a period of time. Before that, actually, whatever in addition to this particular application, what we did is from a manufacturing standpoint, we have also implemented the HMI system where it captures the data and it has been integrated with a recipe model where the recipe will control the utility systems in our API plant. So net, what will happen, whenever a batch process is there, this is being controlled by a recipe system and the data will be flown into the HMI system. And from there, this was integrated into our GMP Pro so that the overall process and overall data is consolidating into one particular area. So next step would be to create the data analytics and create dashboards in all these phases so that we can do the predictive analytics and take care of the quality systems and ensuring the product quality. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Verma. Anything to be add, or we can take Nitesh first to share his thoughts?
We'll take Nitesh and then we can then take it
up. Mr. Nitesh, over to you to speak about. Mr. Nitesh is the head quality assurance with Unichem Laboratories. So Nitesh, your thoughts, please.
Yes, we've seen how different approaches are adopted across all the industry. Basically, to see whatever we have discussed, almost most of the companies are tuned up. Actually, they are bound to tune up with this culture now, because if you see with this COVID and other things, what has happened, the audits and all what we see, it's all remote. And if you want to stay in business, this is the must, because business comes seconds, first is your approval. So what we have seen here is most of the time when we go for advancement, okay, what we say when we are integrating new software, basically this is IT related. This field is a little dynamic in nature. My IT colleague here, Krishna, will comment on this. So when we say this is dynamic, there are a lot of challenges coming. What we basically see, when a simple version change, we say it is version change 4.0 to 5.0. And when we go to 5.0, we have to see how our business is tuned up to 5.0. When we adopt that technology, if my profit out of 4.0 was 1.2 CR, and when I go to 5.0, when my manufacturer says go to 5.0, how much is the return of investment? This is something to do with business. You will say, this guy is from quality, but how this business? So when we talk about this version, in background, there are a lot of work is required, because especially when we say next version, how my manpower is tuned to that, because all this while he was using that old version. Simple example, we are upgrading LIMS now. All this while we were having an old version of LIMS. Now the LIMS, what we are going ahead, is fully integrated. It will be directly linked to SAP. Whatever data is feeding into SAP, LIMS is going to take it. It will be integrated. There are a lot of chances of error there. And when we are saying error, it's a question mark on our regulatory. So the basic challenge what we see when we go for it is integration is how companies tune up to change this culture from one mode to other mode. How your manpower is trained on that part. If you see basic, when we talk about IT engineers, those are qualified people. But what about our operators? The shop floor operators are basically sometimes 10 pass, 12 pass, or max to max their diploma. And when we talk about those people, they are the hardcore workers. they get involved into all basics functioning, and the people who sees that are not in much numbers. So the basic challenge when it comes to adopting this change is how your core people are trained on that part, basically on the operation, and second is regulation. So this is what the basic challenge is when we go for any challenge, any change. This is the point what I want to highlight today, and we have seen what are the advantage, but nobody in this forum have seen talked about disadvantages. I'm a little negative on this part, but let's not forget that, because when it comes to technology, there is always pros and cons. So we have to also see how it is versatile and how we are going to go it in future. Okay, because going and adopting that software and implementing will be the phase one, but time to time changing that software at each stage and tuning yourself into that change will be the challenge we are going to see in future for in industry, and especially when it comes to pharma industry, this technology and regulatory should be in a such a way that they should go hand in hand. Because if one hand fails, other hands will certainly go down. That is what the basic thing what we need to see when we develop such kind of change in any organization. This is what I want to say. Most of the part what I was about to focus here are already covered by other experts. And what we foresee, there is a lot of opportunities coming up in industry in future. People, industry will go certainly. We have talked about Sensex, Nifty, how pharma industry is growing compared to other industry. We say today's share market, it will be almost 10% hike a year a company is growing about. So looking at that growth, technology is very important part of today's base challenge. And what I want to see, know and put forward here is the how people will adopt this change and how company will be tuned up, because there are a lot of things what support are required from directors and management level also. It is not only quality and leaders who are working on this platform will change it, but business, supply chain, and the management should be aligned so that all these functions go in hand in hand. So that's what the point I have today for this discussion. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Nitesh. Just to add to you what you said and to give our perspective on things, I would like to add my two cents, which is change management is constant. First and foremost, change is going to be constant, and change management is going to be the need of the hour. And as you rightly said, new technologies coming in, new versions coming in. Earlier, it was only that, okay, the vendor is responsible for delivering everything. But today, the platform has changed. I think it's a joint engagement with the partner whom we are engaging and the vendor with whom we are engaging, because it's a collective approach where jointly we have to create a success story. And as you rightly said, when you talk about the operators who are in 10th and 12th pass people, and when you talk about the top management, as I said, chain management, we'll have to go from, it's a bottom up and top down approach where everyone will have to work jointly within the organization, within the functions. At the same time, the vendor with whom you have got associated, or a software upgrade is to be required, or any integration has to be required. Earlier, the days were used to blame each other, but today I think that has changed. We have to jointly work, because at the end of the day, so many new things coming up that not one person or not two an organization can be at speed with that kind of stuff. So when we've delivered a lot of projects within our organization, we have done very successful projects when we've basically delivered a huge amount of technology upgrades to DRL and a lot of our other customers. We've never been told that you are a vendor. We are partners. We are working jointly to ensure to create a success benchmark for the overall organizations, where we as well as the customer actually grow together. And if willingly working together, jointly working together, will create a major success story rather than pointing fingers at each other. Because those days are gone. When we start pointing fingers at each other, we are not going to be successful. So it's very, very crucial. Chain management, working together, ensuring success for a project is very, very important. Kamal, your input on this?
Yeah, Shranik, I think there is another challenge is what we are implementing. Sometimes we look at a software component, and when we look at a platform, it is very much different from software. Software can have versions, there are upgrade challenges, we already heard engineering challenges, those things come. But those are independent softwares. When we try to roll out, try to optimize or improve one function. When we are choosing a platform, it means the platform has to work. It has to be open. It has to work with various modules. It has to various protocols. It has to work with various existing technologies which the company has. So when we choose a platform, for example, OSIsoft Pi system, in word, the top 25 pharma companies have adopted the Pi system. It has more than 20,000 installations worldwide. So when we look at a platform and when let's say 5 years back, we were not working on Pi. We were just integrating different PLCs or different web bridges and all that. It was time consuming. Upgrades were difficult, what Nitesh is echoing. But once we started working on a new technology like Pi system, the upgrade happened just like that. There is nothing, no new requirement which comes up. There are a lot of things which are automatic. It is not like we are doing SAP from one version to another, minor upgrade, major upgrade. When OT platforms, we can't disturb anything. Production is very sensitive. Your validations is very sensitive. Quality, very sensitive. Here, the platform upgradation becomes very, very easy. And that's why...
Kamal, just to add to your point, what is happening, the current machine, what we are equipped with the latest technology, basically, those machine supports all these function, what you said. But what about legacy machine? Okay, there are a set of legacy machine which we operate from right from the this plant is started. No. And probably we cannot change those machine in a time. So the basic challenge comes to those machine which are older age, and there that upgradation becomes a major challenge.
Yeah, understand. See, one question is, we were working with Tata Power, for example, and similar challenges we came across in ITC, where when we are integrating with different SCADA system, DCS or PLC system or RTU, there were technological challenges. But because the platforms are there, connectors are there, and there are global people involved, there we call it industry principle. For example, Pi and Aviva has. So we reach out to them, how they have done this in other countries or similar clients. So we get help from them and it becomes much more easier and faster. It's, we are not saying the challenges are not there, but it's a question is how much time we spend in overcoming those challenges. That becomes shorter if you're working on a platform. Yeah.
So we need to basically, Nitesh, very honestly, as Kamal rightly said, since OSI, SOF, and Pi systems are globally deployed in a lot of other organizations, a lot of other pharma companies, I think a lot of Fortune 500 companies are doing. So the idea is to get the best practices from them. Yes, legacy systems continue to be there. The challenges are going to be there. So today, if we are spending, say, 5 days on ensuring that we solve the legacy system, but if we have an industry expert like OSI Soft team who have deployed these kind of solutions across the globe, and they have also gone through these particular use cases and everything, and that's where their expertise and their knowledge as in the, that's the reason I said that it's very, very important to work hand in glove today rather than putting it across by, we showed you the system, it is your problem. No, we have to come together to ensure that we all create a success story. It's about individual KRA KPI as well as the organization KRA KPI, where we are all working towards one goal of creating success for the organization. And that's where we have to basically get knowledge and expertise from OEMs and system integrators who have dealt with these kind of use cases, the experience that OSI Soft or we bring on the table with the kind of work that we've done with a lot of pharma countries and everything. will definitely help. I'm not saying it's going to completely eradicate the issue, but we can mitigate and minimize the thing. That is the only thing we would like to add on.
I think we can ask Sarang also. Sarang, yeah. What are your point of view on this?
Yeah, Sarang can be the best person to actually give his thought on that. Sarang, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. Yeah. I'm audible.
Yeah, you're audible.
Yeah, I was listening to that and I echo what Kamaljit has said. And the same, we have experienced actually that kind of support that we have received from OSSoft and PI and from the industry principal. So, we have experienced. So there is no second thought. Miss, I completely agree with Kamaldeep.
Thanks, Arang. Thanks for seconding us. So, Ekta, over to you.
So I think before I give the closing note, I just don't want to disappoint one of our audience. Mr. Amit Hange has raised his hand and maybe he has one question. So I think we should take it and then I'll quickly go for a wrap. So,
sure.
So Mr. Amit,
Yeah, basically it is not a question, but just I want to add with what Nitesh told. That yes, because of pandemic has forced organization to take the technology on their as a priority. There are many organizations where they are thinking like, okay, technology available, but my business is not required for that, or my business required. But then now organizations are willing to take technology. But one thing is, as a prerequisite, we need to check whether our talent pool is available with us. Is it having that capabilities, competencies, and resilience to take the technology as a challenge and then implement? Because we are, as an organization, we are taking technology means we are paying money for something. That what Nitesh sir told, ROI is very important. What is the return on investment? What management always asks. So that is, I think, these two things are very like a prerequisite. If you have the talent pool which can take the technology, adopt it and implement on a faster track, so that will boost the profitability, what we are talking about. So that's what I want to add with Nitesh sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Amit. And we definitely second what you are also saying. It's, as I said, it's a joint effort by everyone. We alone cannot be successful as a customer. If we start working in silos, we cannot be successful. Return of investment as a partner or as a customer, everyone looks at return of investment when we are doing a transaction, whether we are going to get that kind of profitability for that particular deal or no, whether the investment that you're doing, are we going to get the return of investment also? So it's a journey. When we talk about new technologies, we need to keep our antenna up. We need to keep on building our expertise. We need to keep our people trained to the latest technology trends which are happening. As you rightly said, not everyone can be trained at that level, but certain expertise we need to keep on building. That's the reason we rightly say that we have to invest in the people. Sometimes we say that your quotation is very expensive or you are too high. It's not about being high or low. It's being, you have to invest in people. The technology part is one part of it, but you also need to invest in people.
So I think the basic point here is a practical approach. And when it comes to return of on investment, management always see what is it for me. So if there is some technology which is accepted by industry and it is globally known, but then end of the day, what happened? We always see how much I'm going to get out of it. So that's become one of the challenges. I'm okay. Whatever we discussed some time back, it's fine. It's very transparent and been. But I've seen many organizations later they have realized what is the benefit of that putting together, and they have invested so much of the crores of rupees to come out of it. By not looking into any ROI. So the point here is, initially there is a lot of resistance. Later, when we get this into compliance mode, everyone accepted.
Just to add, this was a situation, but I think now we don't have a choice with post corona. We don't have a choice. It's just that which is the cost effective solution you have to look at. There is no second thought that whether to do or not. It's I think otherwise it's a survival question now. Right. I think it's all of us are at that.
Yeah.
It's a survival question, which is the most cost effective one, like Nitesh said, what which is the best ROI one. One of them you might have to choose and move ahead.
I think absolutely.
One example I would like to quote in one of the industry, we've seen they got a warning letter, and from last 2 years, they cannot produce medicine to US. And that was basically related to dirt cleaning of FPD. Mm-hmm. Okay, all this while we were using this approach of just cleaning the bowl, and then when it comes to duct cleaning, it was very tedious job. But there is a technology now which is directly gives us how that duct can be cleaned by putting some WIP system, and again there are camera system also who can sitting at one desk, anybody can operate it and clean it. So that is how company realized it later, what is the significance. Although there is no major impact on the product quality, but if regulators wants it, we have to adopt it.
Yeah, Nitesh, both the things are happening. For example, we were doing some study with Cadila Pharma and even ITC. Their first question was, what is ROI? If we are getting into, I am investing my people, I am spending time, then can you tell me what are the use cases? What are you going to implement? How the technology will benefit? So there are numbers. We, for example, sign NDA, exchange numbers, exchange profitability, and see, this is what other companies have achieved. For example, Novartis has done something. Pfizer has done something. Dr. Reddy's has done something. If they have achieved this, we can also achieve the similar numbers. Then you work out a basis, and based upon that, projects are getting approved. That is one approach. We have also seen approach which, for example, Tata Power took or Vedanta Group took, where they are very clear that they want a visibility of time series data. They want a central single source of truth. They said, put the data in one place from all the sources. I don't want to spend too much time running behind Siemens or running behind Emerson to get the data at one place. Put it at one place. I know how to use it. And they have also benefited. I mean, during the project, they then start the second phase. Okay, the data has started coming. Let's think about the use cases. So both the approaches do exist. But like Krishna said, things are changing. A couple of things now have to be done. It's imminent. So we have to do that. And this is a journey. It is, there's no end to that. We keep on rediscovering. If there is no ROI, no one is going to invest. It is very clear. We all know that.
Absolutely.
I just want to add here, rather than looking for ROI, we should be looking for cost of not doing it. Then it will create a business. Everything we cannot do.
Absolutely, I think. So
yes, so I think it one very exciting is like every time we do something with VCS, we always go over the time with lots of insight coming out from all speakers. So this is in a way, so we have every time insights coming in from various leaders across. So now, thank you. Just on a closing note, I won't take much time. India's pharmaceutical industry has grown in confidence and is firmly moving on an accelerated growth. The future looks bright and promising with leaders like you having so much insights on it. So on this closing note, I would like to thank all our thought leaders for taking out your precious time Friday evening and being with us. Our partner VCS OSI came here and shared their interesting insights and taking your precious time. Audiences, thank you for being here and making the chat box very engaging with your questions to the speakers. And we shall be updating the video link and sharing with you very soon. Please share your feedback form, which is mentioned on the chat box. And also I've shared the feedback, which mentions about a session, one-on-one brainstorm session with VCS. We would love to connect with you, these guys. So please share your feedback with us on that. And kindly follow us on all social media platforms, that's LinkedIn, Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. Thank you once again, everyone, for being here, and have a nice weekend. Stay safe.
Thank you, everyone. I would like to just add a couple of things to this. I would like to have special thanks to Sarang for coming on board and giving a good insight presentation, which was a very useful and insightful discussion that you had, Sarang. So once again, thank you very much for coming on board. Thanks each and every eminent speaker and thought leader for sharing their insights on this particular platform. I think it was a very engaging and insightful thing. Thank you, Praveen, for joining in and giving an insight on Aviva. And thank you, Kamal and Brandalytics and everyone who's joined this particular Zoom meeting, for making this roundtable a success. As Ikta rightly said, every time we overshoot, this time I think we overshoot by 45 minutes. But it is very, very important to have an engaging session rather than having a monologue. So I am really thankful to each and everyone for taking out time on a Friday evening where things are, businesses are looking up, but still people are taking out time and coming on a platform to exchange their thoughts and everything. So on this behalf, on behalf of VCS and the entire eCubics team, Brandytics team and OSI team, I thank you for joining this particular roundtable. Stay home, stay safe, stay healthy, enjoy your weekend, and thank you once again.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Happy weekend.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.